Shiloh's the meadow, and a soft wind breeze a whisper through the trees. As I lean against a hickory, I close my eyes and I can almost see the ghostly forms of moonlight. I can almost hear the cannons blast. Standing in the presence of the past. The first few waves came chilling, fear and hatred running through their blood. When the day was finally over, those left were wading through the crimson flood. Where some young soldier breathed his last, standing in the presence of the past. Brother fighting brother, father fighting son, by the time the sun was setting, looked like the South.
Good afternoon, and welcome home. It's good to see all of you here. I've got an unusual story that I want to tell you today. It's a story in two parts that hopefully will blend together and will make some sense in the end. Part of what I want to tell you is the story of Company G and the Battle of Shiloh. But I also want to tell you about another extraordinary group of students who became connected to the story of Company G and the Battle of Shiloh. Now, I'll begin with a bit of a disclaimer. Not everything works out perfectly when you try to plan for things to happen on a certain date. we were supposed to have by today the publication of a booklet. This was going to be sort of the grand announcement of this particular thing, which is a documentary history of Company G. Includes some of the correspondence of some of the people who were in the company. It includes essays that students have written about members of the company. It includes newspaper accounts and military records and other sorts of things. You'll hear more about that as we go along. The plan was that we were going to have that basically ready by today. Production delays set in, and it looks like we might be maybe 3 weeks off from the target. But let's just say it's in development. It's going to happen. Part of what I want to do today is to tell you the story of From the Recruiting Elm to the Peach Orchard, Company G and the Battle of Shiloh, and you'll notice the subtitle, A Tale of Two Alumni Experiences. And so I'm going to begin the story a little bit backward, perhaps, because I'm going to begin by talking about maybe that second alumni experience. Back in fall 2001, I was preparing to teach a freshman seminar, which I've had a chance to teach every year for about the last 13 or 14 years. And I was quite excited about the freshman seminar that I was going to be teaching in fall of 2001, because I had 14 students who had signed up for my class, and of those 14, 8 of them were students who had indicated that they were interested in being history majors. And for a history professor, this is heaven. Okay, you know, 8 of the students in my freshman seminar were going to be history majors, and I figured this is perfect. There was a project that I had been bouncing around, something that I wanted to try to do, but I knew that I needed some extra people to pull together. And the idea was to get history students interested in the story of Company G, doing research, writing about the company, telling the story, ultimately putting together the booklet that I described earlier. In other words, we started talking about this 11 years ago, and now here it is, about 3 weeks from finally coming together. Now, this particular group of students was a pretty remarkable group. One of them, Brian Smith, was a Civil War reenactor. And I knew that Brian was really going to be gung-ho about this project. In fact, many of you know Brian's mother, who's also an alum. Mary Jane Smith, and she had been talking to me for about a year before Brian started here. Some of you might recall the On This Day in Eureka History letters that I sent out back in 2000, and so we had sort of cultivated correspondence, and she told me, oh, Brian's definitely coming to Eureka College, and I said, wonderful. You know, this is great. Civil War reenactor is going to be coming to Eureka. There were other students in the group who also had various interests, various passions in history. One of the things that I came to discover along the way, Jamie Newton, Jamie Gavea, was a great writer. And I'm thinking, this is ideal. She's going to be wonderful for the project. Now, I've got to fess up, and Lauren Logson just walked in here. Jamie sort of broke my heart because she became an English major. She took a class with Logsdon, and I would say the rest is history, but the rest is English. So she did. She did take some history courses, but she graduated with a major in English and with a minor in history. And I've never quite forgiven Lauren for that, but those things happen. All right, that happens in the real world. But the idea was to get these students involved in researching, studying the history of Company G, writing essays about Company G, and ultimately putting together the booklet that was going to be produced. Now, the text that we used was a short memoir from a Civil War soldier. It's called Company H, spelled A-Y-T-C-H. Company H. It's the story, basically, of a Tennessee soldier, a Confederate soldier, by the name of Sam Watkins. And what's remarkable about Sam Watkins is even though he was fighting on the other side, he was fighting in many of the same battles that Company G fought in. He was at Shiloh. And the idea was to have the students read this particular narrative, try to understand the story of Company G, try to sort of internalize the experiences that this company had in their time at Eureka, and then ultimately to produce this project in the end. So this was the idea back in the fall of 2001 with this class. One of the things that I do with every one of my freshman seminar classes, and I think it's sort of become pretty customary now with a lot of the freshman seminar classes, is we give them a campus tour, campus history tour, and part of the story that we tell them is the story of the recruiting elm. And I've put two pictures on here purposefully. This is probably the most famous picture that many of you have seen of the recruiting elm. This is facing south from Burris Dickinson Hall. The building that you see right over here is part of the tabernacle that was built back in the 1880s and that stood until 1923. And the grounds back in here is where a lot of the Chautauqua events were held in the summers from the 1890s until about 1930 or so. Now, the picture that you see over here is a postcard, and I've got to tell you the origin of this postcard. I bought this on eBay. I love eBay. And one of the things that's remarkable about this picture is we never quite knew where exactly the recruiting elm stood. But this picture is a remarkable picture because it's one of the few pictures that we now have that shows the recruiting elm in relation to the administration building and in relation to Burgess Hall. And you can actually see some space between the two buildings right there. So one of the things that I had my freshman seminar students do the year that I got this postcard is we did a little bit of a math experiment. We triangulated and we tried to figure out, first of all, the exact spot where the photographer would have been standing, and also to try to figure out as best as we could the exact spot where the recruiting elm stood. And so now we know that if you come out of the administration building and start going down the steps towards Surf Center, it's going to be directly to your left once you get to that first set of stairs. Lauren always asked me this question, where was the recruiting elm? Now we know. Now, I am assuming that most of you in here know the gist of the story, and so I'm not going to go into all the details of what happened beneath the recruiting elm, but shortly after the Civil War had begun, shortly after firing at Fort Sumter in April of 1861, news of the war arrived here in central Illinois. Most of our student body consisted of students from Illinois, but we also had students from Missouri, from Kentucky, from a couple of other places. And there was a spontaneous gathering that basically occurred beneath that majestic tree at the end of chapel one day. We don't know the precise day, but my guess is it was probably the 16th of April. The reason why I say that, Lincoln had already issued his call for volunteers. Lincoln was asking for 75,000 people to volunteer. And what we're going to see is members of this student community, members of the, both students and faculty, are going to make the decision that day that they are going to join a company, they are going to volunteer, they are going to go off to war. To the best of my knowledge, there were about 22 people from this campus who were members of Company G. And my sense is that that number will actually increase over time. Here's what I've actually discovered. There are some students who studied at the Walnut Grove Academy. And so their names appear on the matriculation list for the academy, but not necessarily for the college. And what I found is if we start looking at the academy list, there's additional names that match up for Company G. So I really do believe that perhaps as many as one-third of the members of Company G might well have been students or faculty here at the college. The person that you see in the center, Otis Asa Burgess, was professor at the college at the time, became Captain Burgess of Company G. The other individuals that you see are people who were young 18, 19, 20-year-old students at the time, but eventually went off to war. These are pictures of them later in years. The picture that you see right over here is a picture of Roger B. Dickinson. And some of the letters of Company G that we have are letters that were written by Roger talking about the wound that his brother Charlie suffered at Shiloh. We have other individuals in here that are significant as well. Ben Radford, was not only a member of Company G, but he was also a historian. Ben Radford lived into his mid-90s and was still writing articles in the Woodford County Journal. And many of the articles that he wrote were articles about his Civil War years, his Civil War experience. I've never run across a writer who had such an amazing memory. If Ben Radford is writing about a Civil War experience, and if he tells you the phase of the moon, you can bank on it. It's accurate. He just had an amazing memory about his experiences. And much of what we've learned about Company G, we've learned through Ben Radford's stories that he's written. James Waggett, fellow that you see down in the lower right corner, was a student. During the war, became an assistant to a surgeon during the war. When he came back from the war, he went to what was then the equivalent of medical school. After getting his medical degree, he went out west, first to the Washington Territory, Washington State, and later to a place called Hawaii. And he opened up hospitals in both locations. He opened up one of the first psychiatric hospitals in the Pacific Northwest. And in the state of Washington to this day, there's a lake in Washington that's named after Waggett. Other individuals, I didn't put all the pictures up here, but many of you might be familiar with the story of Jonathan Harvey Rowell, person who became the second captain of Company G. When Professor Burgess resigned from the military, Johnny Rowell was named captain. He had been a math major when he was in college here. After the war, he became a congressman. Now, many of you might remember about 5 years ago receiving this copy of the Eureka College magazine. One of the reasons that we featured Rowell is because about 5 years ago, we received the Rowell papers. We have these papers in the college archives, including the day books of Company G, including the pocket diary that Johnny Rowell carried with him during the war, including original copies of speeches that Rowell made when he was a member of Congress. In fact, if you go through his pocket diary, what you'll find out is he really was a math major. When he wasn't fighting battles, he was actually doing math problems in the margins of his diary. But you see, one of the things over the years, over the past 11 years, there's a lot more that we've learned about Company G because we've acquired the Rowell papers, we've discovered new things. So the telling of the story, you know, there's more that had to be added in than the research that had been done back in fall of 2001. Now, to reconnect the story to the students that I was telling you about, my freshman seminar back in fall of 2001, our class met at 1 o'clock on Tuesdays. And we met in Burgess 103. 14 students, myself, there was a peer leader working with the group. We were studying the Civil War. We were trying to become immersed in the Civil War. They had already heard the story about the recruiting elm. During the semester, we actually went to some Civil War sites. We went to things, went to museums. This sounds perhaps a little bit goofy, but I bought some hardtack, Civil War biscuits, and everybody got a chance to do this. It was almost, in a weird sense, it was almost like a communion experience of sorts, that basically we had the breaking of the bread, the breaking of the hardtack, and perhaps the breaking of the teeth along the way. If you've ever eaten that stuff, you know that it's, you got to be hungry. You got to be hungry to do hardtack. But again, let me remind you that this was a class in fall of 2001. We met on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock. Tuesday, September 11th, 2001, was one of our class days. Now that morning, most classes didn't meet. Most of the student body that morning was gathered in the Burgoo watching television, in the library. You know, basically everybody was glued to a television set that morning. By the afternoon, events had happened, events had transpired, but there was still a tremendous amount of uncertainty. I questioned whether or not I should meet with my freshman seminar that day. They'd only been in college for 3 weeks. They were 18 years old. And something that most adults couldn't handle very well had transpired. I made the decision to meet with them. We were going to put aside the regular materials for the day. We were going to talk about events, and we were going to talk about life. Topic, by the way, for that day, had we gone according to the syllabus, was heroes. Do we really need heroes? I remember the conversation that we had that day, and I struggled to try to give the right answers to the questions that they were asking. Several students that day spoke openly about quitting school and joining the military. Nobody knew who was the enemy that struck us. Nobody knew what the outcome was going to be. But 3 weeks into their college education, they were already thinking about ditching the college experience and basically becoming individuals in service to their nation. I told them to give some thought to that decision, not to do anything rash, but to wait and see. Ultimately, some of the members of my freshman seminar did serve in the military. This is a picture that Chet Hammond sent me from Afghanistan. And I don't know if you can, I'm not used to all the buttons here. I don't know if you can tell, but this is a Richwoods High School Knights flag that he's displaying in Afghanistan. I think a couple of other members of the company that he was with were actually from Richwoods. I got email correspondence when it was possible from Chet, and he basically talked about events that he was experiencing as a soldier in the War on Terror. One of the other people who was a member of the group was Kurt Gerritsen. This is a picture of Kurt as a Peace Corps worker in Niger. He spent 2 years of his life in the poorest country of the world, country in West Central Africa that has a large Muslim population. In addition to the time that he spent in Niger, Kurt also spent 2 years after finishing school living in Japan and teaching English, English as a second language, to students in Japan. I remember when Kurt was a freshman, one of the things that he told me is he wanted to travel as much as he could while he was a student at Eureka College. He wanted to punch his passport as much as possible. By the time that he graduated from this school, he had visited 7 countries. Now, one of the reasons why I tell you these stories, and there's others that I could add in this, is because one of the things that I came to realize is that when you're looking for heroes, when you're looking for those who will follow the call of duty, when you're looking for those who will recognize those timeless values, service, call to duty, finding a cause that's larger than yourself, they're still with us. They're still here today. One of the reasons that I came to realize that the booklet that they had started working on 11 years ago had to be completed is because not only does it do honor to the members of Company G, to those people who gathered beneath the recruiting elm in 1861, but it also tells the story of those who gathered in the fall of 2001 in the shadow of a memory of a recruiting elm and learned stories about heroism, courage, valor, service, leadership, all of those things that we say are central to our identity as an institution. Sarah Young was a member of my freshman seminar in 2001. She wasn't a history major, but she was an art major. One of the things that she contributed to the booklet was this ink sketch, basically, of what she imagined that the recruiting elm gathering might have looked like. And we're going to be incorporating her artwork into the booklet when it is produced. Now, I'm going to give you a brief history lesson. There's no test, I promise. And I'm not going to go into all the details, but Company G was a part of the army that General Grant ultimately commanded in the Western theater of the Civil War. The Battle of Shiloh itself was fought April 6th and 7th of 1862. Now, if you remember, I told you we don't know the exact date of the recruiting elm event, but my guess is that it was the 16th of April. So this would have been roughly a year from the time that they had gathered beneath a tree on this campus and made the commitment to go off to war. The soldiers of Company G did have previous military experience, because with Grant, they had fought in battles at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson on the Tennessee and Cumberland River. This was in February of 1862. So basically from February to April, they had made their way down south. Now, we're talking about Western Tennessee. And by the way, just as an aside here, we had talked last year about trying to put together some type of alumni trip to Shiloh for the sesquicentennial. And I think it would have been a great thing to do. However, it fell over Easter weekend. And the ability to be able to coordinate that and get people down and back in time for other commitments was probably too difficult to pull together. But, you know, we did consider doing that, and there was a huge commemoration that took place down at Shiloh. Now, because the members of Company G had previous military experience, remember, they had fought at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson. When they got to Shiloh, they were considered to be seasoned veterans. They had already seen war. In fact, one member of the 17th Illinois, which is the company, the regiment to which Company G belonged, was sent over to talk to some new Ohio recruits who had just got to Shiloh. They had never seen war before. And so the soldier from the 17th Illinois was sent over to try to explain to them how to prepare for this. And he said, "Don't worry about it at all. It's just like you're shooting squirrels. But them squirrels got guns." The army that Grant had taken had secured Cairo, Illinois, made its way to Paducah, had gone down to Fort Henry and Fort Donelson, and basically was following the Tennessee River southward toward Shiloh. They weren't really anticipating that they were going to encounter Southern troops anytime soon. And essentially, the Battle of Shiloh is going to be a bit of a surprise. Grant is caught essentially unprepared. They weren't quite ready to fight that day at Shiloh. Now, one other thing that I want to say just as preface to this, one of the reasons why this battle is going to be so significant and so central to our understanding of the Civil War is in this one battle of the Civil War, which is fought very early in the war, more Americans will die than died in all the previous wars that we had fought up to that point in history. So for anyone who thought that the Civil War was going to be an easy encounter, just a few weeks and out, events like Shiloh convinced them that this was not going to be the kind of circumstance. This was going to be a very, very different kind of conflict. I'm going to give you a brief description of how Grant's army was structured. And I'm going to mention some numbers. Now, keep in mind that these numbers are not going to be exact, because you never had the exact number that you were supposed to have in every company and every regiment and so on and so forth. But the way that armies were organized, if we start from the bottom going up, companies would form. And a lot of times these companies were formed by people who knew one another. Friends would volunteer at the same time and they would join a certain company. A typical Civil War company, if it was at full strength, generally had 100 members. Now that doesn't mean it's always going to have 100 members, because remember, there's going to be people who die along the way, there's going to be people who are injured along the way, there's some who go AWOL, there's some who are lost, some who become prisoners. During the war, there's other people who join the company, so not everybody joins right at the beginning, some join during the war. But we can assume that a typical company would have 100 men. Now, if you had 10 companies, and if you put 10 companies together, that would form a regiment. So Company G was a part of the 17th Illinois Volunteer Infantry. So Company G was about 100 men in a 1,000-person regiment, which was the 17th Illinois. The commander of the regiment, actually, I'll take that back. It's not him. The commander of the regiment was an officer by the name of Major Enos Wood. So Major Wood was basically the commander of the 17th. Now, the next step up beyond regiment is when brigades form. And a brigade during the Civil War could be anywhere from 3 to 5 regiments. So you could have, on the low end, 3 regiments, on the high end, 5. The regiment that this company was involved with at Shiloh had 4 regiments, or the brigade had 4 regiments, and Julius Wraith, fellow that you see here, was the person who was the commander of the brigade. Wraith was originally from Germany. At the time of Shiloh, he was 43 years old. He was a veteran of the Mexican War. He had actually seen military experience shortly after he arrived in the U.S. as an immigrant. He lived in the town of O'Fallon, Illinois, where he and his brother operated a mill. And during the Civil War, because he was a person who did have previous military experience, he was basically given a sufficient rank to be a brigade commander. Wraith is going to be mortally wounded at the Battle of Shiloh. If you go to the battlefield today, you'll find a memorial, a Wraith memorial that's there. A mini ball struck him in the leg, just right above the kneecap. He was on the field of battle for 24 hours before he was taken away. They put him on a steamboat to take him up the Tennessee River to try to get medical attention. And while he was on the steamboat, they amputated his leg below the knee. He developed tetanus, and within 4 days, he was dead. Wraith had been shot at 10 o'clock in the morning on the Sunday, April 6th, the very first day of the battle. So the brigade commander was basically out of action during most of the time that Company G was engaged in the fight. Now, if you put several brigades together, the next rank upward is what is called a division. And the divisions are generally commanded by a general. General John Alexander McClernand was the general who was commanding the 1st Division of Grant's Army of the Tennessee. McClernand is one of those characteristic political generals. He was from Southern Illinois. He was a Democrat. He was a friend of Lincoln's. He had served during the Black Hawk War, as had Lincoln. He was a lawyer, as was Lincoln. And what Lincoln wanted to do is Lincoln wanted to make sure that Southern Illinois stayed within the Union orbit. Many of you who know a bit about Illinois history are well aware that the southern part of the state actually considered the idea of secession, breaking away and creating the state of Egypt, and basically joining with Kentucky. Technically, Kentucky hadn't broken away, but you know, Kentucky soldiers were fighting for both sides. There was this fear that Southern Illinois might well join the Confederacy somehow. And so taking a person like John Alexander McClernand and making him a ranking officer, you know, Lincoln thought that this was going to be a good move. McClernand was a horrible commander. You've probably heard stories about people who complained about Grant's drinking. That was McClernand. You know, he would write letters to Lincoln and to others saying, you know, Grant's an alcoholic. And Grant got so upset with this guy that later he's going to have him removed and sent to the East. And then McClernand does the same thing with General McClellan. He starts complaining about McClellan. He never got along with anyone. Okay, he was always basically second-guessing his superior officers. Grant is going to be the commander who is going to be in charge of the Army of the Tennessee. So basically, he is the person who is supervising the entire operation. But keep in mind, he was caught off guard. And immediately after the Battle of Shiloh, for a brief time, Grant was briefly demoted. A lot of people aren't aware of this. But Shiloh was considered to be such a disaster in terms of losses. You know, even though the Union had won the battle, Grant was basically, brought down a notch in terms of his command capacity. Later, he would be restored because Lincoln admired Grant. Lincoln said, you know, here's a general who fights. You got to love these kinds of maps. I'm going to give you the briefest possible description that I can of events in the battle line. This is Confederate forces that are advancing toward the west, and they're on the south side of the Tennessee River. If you follow the Tennessee River up this way, eventually it's going to take you to Nashville. So Union forces had come down the Tennessee River, and they basically were camped out at a place called Pittsburgh Landing. For those of you who are wondering, Pittsburgh Landing is actually the name of the town. It's a local town. And Southerners to this day still call this battle the Battle of Pittsburgh Landing instead of the Battle of Shiloh. Shiloh is the name that the North gave to the battle. Shiloh comes from the name of a church. There was a church called the Shiloh Church, which you see right over here. And so because of the name of the church, the Union forces call this the Battle of Shiloh. Shiloh, as many of you know, is a Hebrew word meaning a place of peace. When Confederate forces attacked, they attacked early on an April morning, a Sunday morning. It was Palm Sunday. Many of the soldiers were just waking up. They weren't expecting a battle. Confederate forces basically run out of the woods and attack them. The ultimate plan the Confederate forces had is they wanted to drive the Union camp away from the river and down towards this particular creek that you see right over here, which I believe is called Owl Creek. So they wanted to force the Union forces away from Pittsburgh Landing and get them down in this area where the creek is located, and supposedly this was considered to be sort of swampy bottom land. Now, Company G, part of the 17th Illinois, part of the brigade that Raith was commanding, and part of the 1st Division that McClernand was commanding, is located right along this road, right in this general area here. You'll notice you can see the name where it says McClernand right there. Now, to get your direction straight, you have to sort of face the way that they were facing. They're fighting here. They're facing Confederates that are here. And the 17th Illinois was all the way to the right of the line. So in other words, the 17th is right about in this area right here. If you go to Shiloh today, you can actually find some markers that will show you the exact locations where the 17th was located. Now remember, what Confederate forces want to do is Confederate forces want to move Grant's forces from the river. So what they're doing, think of it this way, it's not just a direct attack, it's sort of a sweeping and turning attack. So they're coming this way and they want to turn the Union line. What's going to happen with Company G, where they're located here, is they're going to end up right in the center of the action. Right in the worst possible place. And to give you an idea of how bad it is, they're going to end up for about a 1.5 hour phase on the Sunday morning facing fire from two sides. They're going to be receiving fire from directly in front, and they'll also be receiving fire from their left. So they're basically getting an artillery barrage from two directions. Confederate infantry are advancing from two directions. And just to give you a rough idea of the 1,000 members in the regiment, at the end of the Battle of Shiloh, the casualty count for the 17th Illinois is going to be 138. Now that includes killed and wounded. But 138, 13.8% roughly, assuming they had exactly 1,000, 13.8% of the 17th will be casualties at Shiloh. Very high, very high. I mentioned to you that the 17th was located right about over here. You'll notice that Sherman is located here near the Shiloh Church. This is William Tecumseh Sherman. Sherman was another division commander at Shiloh. He had not yet made his big name reputation yet. He was still sort of a flunky, or it's not fair to say that, but you know, he wasn't yet William Tecumseh Sherman that everybody knows of. So he was a division commander, and members of Company G in the second day of battle are actually going to be absorbed into part of the division that Sherman was commanding, partly because their division had been so decimated the day before. Remember, Raith was dead, McClernand was an idiot. So basically what's going to happen is the remnants of the 17th are going to be fighting with Sherman on the second day of the battle. The song that you heard at the very beginning, country song by Daryl Worley, talks about the 2 days of the battle, and you might recall hearing that, you know, at the end of the first day it seemed the South had won. And Southerners indeed thought that they had won the battle. But what Grant was counting on was reinforcements. There were troops that were being sent from Nashville down the Tennessee River. They were under the command of a general by the name of Don Carlos Buell. And what Grant was hoping is that Buell was going to hurry up, that he was going to get there quickly. Grant had about 48,000 soldiers when this battle started. Buell had about another 17,000. So with that combined force, Grant and Buell together would have about mid-60s. Confederate forces, the numbers vary a little bit, but probably somewhere in the range of 43, 44,000 Confederates engaged in this battle. So the first day, things looked quite well for the South. It seemed as though the South had carried the day. During the night, Buell arrives. They start unloading those additional 17,000 forces. They basically hurry them out to the positions in the battlefield where they're going to be needed. And they are going to be engaged in the second day. And by the second day, we're going to see a Union victory. The area that you're looking at here, right in here through this area, much of this part of the battlefield was a peach orchard. And this is the ground, basically, where most of the fighting that Company G was involved with would have taken place. They were fighting in the peach orchard, which really is a little bit unusual because this was considered to be pretty much open ground. Now they have they've replanted peach trees here, and this picture is a few years old, but I'm assuming the peach trees are doing a little bit better now. But they've replanted peach trees in the peach orchard. Much of the Battle of Shiloh was actually fought within a forested area, and the area where the peach orchard existed was probably one of the more wide open spaces, basically where the battle did transpire. Otis Asa Burgess who had been a college professor had to lead his students, had to lead his men in battle. And even more difficult than that, Otis Asa Burgess had to write to the parents of those students, those men who had fallen. Those of you who were here last year for Alumni Weekend might recall hearing a letter that Professor Burgess wrote to Joel and Jemima Skelton. They were friends of his. They went to the church here in town. Their son Jimmy was one of the first to fall at Shiloh. And when you hear the words that Burgess had to write in talking about how their son died for a cause greater than himself, that he died in service to his country, it's just sort of dripping with emotion. In fact, when I read this last year, and I promise you this was not timed this way, but I had music that was going on in the background, Civil War music, and it just so happened that the theme song from the Ken Burns series, Ashokan Farewell, all of a sudden came on, and I'm reading the letter that Burgess wrote, and I'm a wimp. Okay, I started choking up here. I mean, it's difficult to read this. But think about how difficult it had to be for Otis Asa Burgess. These were his students. You're not supposed to have to do this. Now keep in mind that their world had been normal until April of 1861. Johnny Rowell was probably thinking of nothing more than finishing his degree and doing more mathematics. Ben Radford wanted to be a journalist, wanted to be a writer. They all had their dreams, they all had their ambitions. But they came to this place, and circumstance, history, fortune, all coincided, transformed who they were, transformed their experience. The education that they got was more than they probably ever bargained for. And wartime experience, dealing with tremendous stress, dealing with a nation that was under duress, this was part of the experience. 11 years ago, in the shadow of a tree, I talked to 18-year-olds about honor, valor, history, service, a calling greater than yourself. Little did I know that their world was going to change, and that in many of the same respects, they would follow the same path that some of these individuals 140 years earlier had followed. The song that you heard at the beginning talked about the importance of place. You all know that this is a very important place. You know, for many of you, this is home. But in addition to place, we connect story with place. Many of you in your time here can think of the story of your lifetime, the story that you've put together, that you've woven together. But keep in mind that the place that we call Eureka has a connection that goes well beyond this campus, goes well beyond this state, well beyond this nation, well beyond this world. Yet the stories that we tell, the values that we hold dear, those are timeless and they travel quite well. Thank you for your kind attention. Within a few weeks, we hopefully will have Remembering Company G, a documentary history, Company G of the 17th Illinois. So hopefully by, well, certainly for homecoming, they'll be available, and next alumni weekend, we'll make sure they're available, and we'll advertise once they're around. But thanks again. Appreciate your being here. Thanks.